Hello, and welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is the podcast where we talk all things screenwriting, filmmaking, and breaking into the industry. I'm your host, Phil Galasso. Today we have an interview with James Vanderbilt, writer of the new Netflix film Murder Mystery, starring Adam Sandler and Jennifer Aniston. We discuss the film's record-breaking opening weekend on Netflix, James's influences when writing the script, his writing process, and much more. Check it out. Well, I'm here with James Vanderbilt, writer of Murder Mystery. James, thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So this is pretty cool. Netflix, who is not necessarily always sharing their numbers, they're sharing more and more now. You guys had the biggest opening weekend ever.
That's pretty crazy, right?
How many people does that mean saw it?
The way they sort of explained it to me was, I think it was 30.9 million individual accounts. And so, and in order to be counted, you have to have completed 70% of the movie. So if you watched an hour of the movie and turned it off, it wouldn't count. I don't know who turns a movie off 70% of the way in, but God bless you. If you got to 71%, fantastic, it counted. But I really, by the way, I hope you didn't. I've done something wrong if you're turning the movie off 71% of the way in. And then they sort of go, you know, not all of those accounts is one person on their own. So I think they count them for like 2-point-something people. So it's they were saying something along the lines of like 80 million people saw it the first 3 days, which is mind-blowing to me.
Yeah, that is mind-blowing. Well, my girlfriend and I were two of those millions and millions of people and really enjoyed the movie. Talk a little bit about, this didn't start with Adam Sandler, right? This was a script you had written before he got involved?
So the way it started was, it's actually the longest project I've ever gotten worked on. So in about 13 years ago, I was having drinks with Tripp Vinson, who's another producer on the movie, and a guy named Jason Reed, who's a producer, but at the time worked at Disney. And we were just sort of talking about, we just worked on something else together. And we were sort of talking about all of the movies we grew up with and, you know, and the sort of stuff we loved and kind of stuff you couldn't make anymore. We sort of got into the conversation of like, you can't make movies like X anymore, you know, and we were talking about Clue and we were talking about The Last of Sheila. I don't know if you know, which is a great.
Oh, yeah. Anthony Perkins, one of my favorites.
Right. Isn't that great? James Mason. One of my favorites is Murder by Death, which was Neil Simon's movie, which is great. And it's also sort of like slightly famous for being the movie that Alec Guinness did right before Star Wars. Mm-hmm. So he was like on the set reading. The story goes he was on the set reading Star Wars and they were like, what's that? And he's like, ah, it's this thing. I'm going to go do it. But anyway, so we got sort of chatting about that. And we sort of talked about you can't make a movie anymore where like the detective calls everybody together in the third act and explains who did it. And I'm sort of the type of person where it's like, you can't. You tell me, we start talking about how you can't do something. I'm like, well, we obviously we have to try and do that. And so, and Jason was a studio executive at the time. We sort of like brainstormed the whole thing out. And he said, look, if you guys are serious about this, come in next week and pitch it to me for real. And we did. And he bought it. And it's got set up at Disney. And that's how I ended up writing the first draft of the script. And then soon after that, Disney made the first Pirates of the Caribbean, and it was such a huge hit that it kind of changed the ethos of what they wanted to make there. So Jason came to us, this is about a year after we bought it, we'd done a couple drafts, he said, look, it's just not going to get done here. Like our new brief is to sort of make more of our own sort of IP branded stuff. So he was kind enough to give it back to us. And from then on, it kind of went through a bunch of different iterations with a bunch of different people involved. And it always sort of got close to being made, never, but we could never quite get, you know, sometimes we would have the director and an actor, but not an actress. Sometimes we would have the director and the actress, but not an actor. Sometimes we have the actor and the actress, but not a director. I mean, it just every sort of possible permutation of it almost sort of happened. And then about, I'd say about 5 years ago, and this is something that sort of never happens, we got an incoming call from Adam Sandler, who had been given it by his agent. And he'd read it and loved it. And, you know, wanted to jump into it. And for various sort of external reasons, that version of it, again, almost happened and didn't come together. But when Adam ended up at Netflix, he raised his hand again and he said, look, I'm over here now. I want to make it here. I want it to be one of my movies over here. And Netflix got behind it really, really quickly. And he sent it to Jennifer Aniston and she jumped on really quickly. So it was one of those things where legitimately we were, and my apologies for the long answer, but it's a long history.
No.
Where I was basically convinced it would never get made. And then a day later, we were in soft prep. Like it was crazy. So it was a 13-year overnight success.
That's how it happens, I guess.
Oh, of course, yeah.
So the pairing of Adam and Jennifer Aniston, I mean, they have great chemistry together. You know, that must have been really nice to see, you know, after spending so much time with this project, especially seeing the characters come to life.
It was really great. And it was what was, I think, so, I mean, what's so great about this for me is not only did the movie finally get made, which I sort of had gotten to a point where I was like, this one will never get made, but the best version of it got made in my mind. And so the great thing about Adam and Jen together, and Adam was the one who was like, no, this is, you know, this is who should play Audrey, is that they're so kind of in both their own way, they're so sort of quintessentially American. Like, he plays that sort of blue collar American sort of, for lack of a better word, schlub so well. And she's such a, like, so identifiable as this wonderful American woman who's witty and funny and Rachel from Friends, that, and that's kind of baked into the premise of the movie. So I felt like the casting of it was, we got so lucky.
They have a really great part, I guess, partially just because of their history, like a real lived in quality that makes the relationship seem legitimate.
Yeah. And that was sort of the thing I always sort of felt like was if the movie sort of succeeds or fails on the two of those roles, and if you believe them and you believe that they're married, then you sort of give the movie permission to go off and do all these crazy things because you're grounded by these two people. And if they don't work and they aren't believable sort of as two people who love each other, then the whole thing falls apart. So, and what's sort of crazy too is that, I mean, they've known each other forever, but this is only the second time they've worked together. It feels like they're a comedy team, like mm-hmm. they've done a bunch of these, but this is only their second film.
When I was watching it, I got a little bit of a Thin Man vibe, and they had like the Nick and Nora thing that it does seem like they've made several movies together.
No, absolutely. And by the way, that's why it's Nick and Audrey, because it's a Thin Man sort of, that's one of the obvious influences on the movie. So to actually finding two people who were great about being able to do that banter and also bringing their own stuff and being able to sort of improvise in the moment and make each other look good, is super, super lucky.
And it's almost like with the two of them, and I mean, I think this is obviously baked into the premise, like you said, like they walked into a different type of movie, a totally different genre, and you've got all the actors there to support that. I mean, Terrence Stamp is amazing.
How cool is that, Terrence Stamp's in this movie? Like, I couldn't believe it.
Yeah, it's really well done. So let's just go back a little bit and talk about how you got your start as a writer.
I got my start, I'm from Connecticut originally, and I came out to USC I wanted to go to the film school. I didn't get into the film school, and I got into the general education program at USC, and I didn't get into any other colleges. I went to my father and I said, look, I think I need to, you know, I want to take a year off and reapply to some places. And my father looked at me and laughed, and he was just like, you're going to college. So I came out to, California, and I found out once I was here that about the writing program at USC, which is a much sort of smaller, it's sort of a tiny part of the film school. And especially an undergraduate, there were only 24 students a year. So it was, whereas like production, they're like 200 kids a year get it. So it's like, it just was sort of not an afterthought, but it was a really small part of the film school, and I didn't know about it. And I got in my second year, which was great. I got a fellow student who I'd made friends with, a guy named Chris Fedak, wrote me a recommendation, who's now this great, wonderful TV writer who created Chuck. And so I went to film school for 4 years, and right as I was graduating, I had to write a thesis script for my senior year, and I hated it. And it was really bad. It was all my fault. I tried to write this big sort of Jerry Bruckheimer type adventure film, and it was just terrible. And so like to kind of cleanse my palate in my spare time, I wrote this romantic comedy and that I sort of fell in love with. And I met this guy named Mikkel Bondesen my senior year, who's a friend of a friend. And he was an intern at a production company at Sony, and he really wanted to be a literary manager. And he said, I want to be a literary manager. And he was from Denmark, and this really sweet guy. And I said, well, like, who do you represent? And he was like, nobody. And I was like, that's a terrible pitch. But he had, he had no clients, and I had no other prospects. So I was like, well, I'll sure. Okay, fine.
Perfect fit. You
know, perfect fit. Sell this. And then he sold it. And I was like, oh, you have amazingly proved me wrong. And he ended up selling the script on a Thursday. And I graduated from USC on a Saturday. And I went to my first a studio meeting at Warner Brothers on a Monday. So it was this crazy transition from sort of the theoretical in college to, okay, I'm actually like driving onto the Warner Brothers lot.
Yeah, that's a pretty, that's a whirlwind right there. 4 days, 5 days.
It was really amazing. Driving onto the Warner Brothers lot in my 1984 Oldsmobile station wagon that looked like it was out of Chevy Chase's Vacation. Like it was like the family truckster parking under the water tower, incredibly embarrassed in it.
Starting out, were there movies, and even before, were there movies or television shows or even books or that particularly inspired you or that still inspire you?
Absolutely. I go to kind of classics, you know, like The Godfather is my favorite movie. And I grew up in the 80s. So, you know, Die Hard and Lethal Weapon and all James Cameron stuff, Aliens, yeah, were incredible. I love, there was a TV show in the early 90s that I loved called Homicide, Life on the Street, which
David
was actually
Simon, yeah.
The David Simon thing, which was based on David Simon's book. And interestingly enough, David Simon didn't become a screenwriter until I think the last season of it. And he was like, well, I should learn how this works. And then, of course, David Simon became David Simon. That was a show that was tremendously influential to me. And I loved it. I just studied. And then later I wrote a movie called Zodiac. And a lot of that was sort of based on the idea of...
I can sort of see the influence of Homicide on Zodiac now that you mentioned that. I mean, Zodiac's absolutely one of my favorite movies. And it's interesting because... it's a mystery, but it's very much, it subverts the mystery tropes in very different ways than murder mystery subverts mystery tropes.
Yes, very, yeah.
In that, you know, it's a mystery without a real answer.
Exactly. In murder mystery, we give you answers. So, I mean, all of, you know, his, the sort of the way he blended, and I'm also, if I hadn't gone into sort of this, I probably would have tried to go into journalism. And so sort of looking at David Simon, who started as a journalist, started, you know, Homicide is based on him being an embedded reporter with the Baltimore Homicide Division for a year. So sort of looking at real life through the lens of a reporter, looking at a murder investigation through the lens of a reporter was always sort of fascinating to me.
Yeah, there are still episodes of Homicide that I think about every once in a while, like the Robin Williams one.
Oh, yeah. Bob
Gunn. Whenever I think of that one, I'm just like, oh.
Oh, it's amazing. And they had great directors, too. Not to go down the rabbit hole, but like they had, like Catherine Bigelow did like the season 6 2-part finale. Like Barry Levinson obviously helped create the show, but did that Robin Williams one. They have Peter Medak did a bunch of them. Like they had amazing kind of directors coming through and directing TV back then when film directors didn't do that.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a very cinematic show. So let's talk about Zodiac a little bit, since you brought it up, and since it, like I said, it is one of my favorite movies. What's the, you know, working on a movie like that? So how did that start? Was Fincher making, you know, Zodiac, and then you got brought on, or did you have the rights to the book?
No, it actually, the way it sort of happened was I had read the book when I was about 16 years old, and I was trying to write a novel about a serial killer. And this was, by the way, in the early 90s. So a 16-year-old writing a novel about a serial killer didn't ping anyone as a problem. I think now I would have the police at my door immediately. But I was doing research, and I came across this book written by Robert Graysmith, and it was just, you know, the first Zodiac book is so fascinating because it is this idea, which I think is amazing, was he was this political cartoonist who decided to hunt down the Zodiac killer, which makes no sense when you really think about it. It's like, are you insane?
A little bit, I think.
Very much so, in a wonderful way. And then the way the book is written is it's written. I recommend everybody read it.
It is a great book.
Incredible mystery, and like you're in his head. So I always sort of went, this would be an amazing film. When I first got a career, you know, sort of that, you know, you go to these general meetings, you get a manager, you get an agent, and they say, what's the thing you've always wanted to do? And I always said, I wanted to do this book, Zodiac. And as soon as I got an agent, I said that, and the agent came back to me and said, actually, the rights are taken. They're of all places, by the way, Disney had optioned it years ago. And this was back when Disney would make R-rated movies like the Hollywood Pictures years.
Sure.
But I sort of went, okay, I guess, you know, not to be. And then right after the first movie I wrote that actually got made came out.
Basic?
Basic. It was called Basic. And the guy who helped produce it with me, Brad Fisher, said, if you could ever do, you know, he gave me that question. I said, there's this book, Zodiac, but the rights are not available. And he looked and he checked and he said, actually, it fell out of Disney, the rights were available again, but there are a bunch of different people going after them. And so I wrote, and I found out through him that the reason the movie hadn't been made was they didn't want to make it R-rated, and because the violence would be too much, and that they also, and this is sort of the inherent problem with the story for a lot of people, is they don't catch him. Spoiler alert to a 13-year-old movie, they don't catch the Zodiac Killer. Huh. And they also didn't want to do it. Weirdly, they didn't want to do it, period. So I don't know what that project morphed into. But I wrote a letter to Robert Graysmith, and I sort of explained to him my history just reading his book. And I said, look, I can't guarantee you I can get this movie made, but I will guarantee you that if we get it made, it'll be R-rated, it will be period, and it'll be true to the fact they didn't catch him at the end. And he gave us the rights, which was incredible. And I sort of said I'd had not a great experience on Basic. It was, you know, I was young and you know, it was John McTiernan, who's this amazingly huge director. So I was immediately fired and then rehired and then fired again. And
my lasting memory of that movie is John Travolta topless.
Yes, he's got like that was sort of like the moment where he was like, no, I have not gained weight. Check this out. I've been working out for like, and he looked great, by the way. Yeah, God
no,
bless.
No shade. I'm just, that's
no, absolutely.
You've seen that movie years ago.
You're not expecting, by the way, it is not a movie that demands anybody appear without a shirt in it either, but he is, there he is in all his glory. God bless. He worked for it. The way I describe Basic is it's the movie that John Travolta and Samuel L. Jackson that's not Pulp Fiction. And we'll leave it at that. But so it was amazing to get a movie made, but the actual experience of it hadn't been as great. And this had been a book I loved forever. So I sort of said, look, I'll make you guys a deal. I'll write this on spec and you get the rights to the book, and it'll be like that. It'll be like in War Games. We each have a key and you have to turn the keys together. So that made me a producer on it. That gave me director approval. That gave me cast approval, you know, so it's sort of, it was, you know, it's I trust you, you trust me, which was great. And then I went out and I did a bunch of research and met with Robert Graysmith and went up to San Francisco and went to Lake Berryessa and with him and wrote this first draft, which was way too long.
How many pages was it, just out of curiosity?
The first draft was 157 pages. The shooting script ended up being longer, which was hysterical with Fincher. But I finished the draft, and we sort of said, okay, you know, who are we going to get to direct it? And it was like, okay, well, we'll send it to David Fincher so he can turn it down, and we can really, you know, it's sort of like, we know the prettiest girl in school is not going to go to prom with us, but like, we'll ask her, so at least we don't feel like, you know, we didn't take the shot. And what I didn't know was that he actually had grown up in the Bay Area and been one of those kids on those school buses that were followed by helicopters that the Zodiac said he was going to shoot kids off of. And the way he sort of talked about it was that whole experience was the first time he knew that evil existed in the world. And so he was like, he was interested. And we went and sat down with him. And I remember saying, he's like, I don't want to make another serial killer movie. I want to make the last serial killer movie. And so I was blown away. I was such a huge fan of his, and Fight Club, sort of brilliant film. And he hadn't directed a movie in 5 years. It was this period.
Yeah, he takes his time.
He took his time. And this was sort of a really, you know, sort of like long period. And he was like, listen, I think the script is really interesting. He said, I want to put it away and I just want to research it. And we spent the next year and a half just researching the case, I mean, to a granular level, because he also sort of said, I won't make the movie unless I can use everyone's real name. Because they didn't, in the book, they don't use everyone's real name, especially mm-hmm. the people that, you know, they may accuse of being murderers. Mm-hmm. And he was like, no, I want to use everyone's real name. And legal came back to us and said, well, that's impossible. And he said, well, I'm not doing the movie. And they said, well, hold on. If you do that, you have to source everything. Like, you actually have to double source every moment in the movie, either from someone who was there or from police or court documents. And that's what we ended up doing. And it was just
wow.
It was an incredible experience.
The level of that, of the painstaking detail of the research, certainly shines through in the final picture. But man, I didn't realize it was that bad.
It was pretty crazy. But it was also sort of a wonderful, it's like you have to, you know, it's like defending your thesis. You have to sort of prove it. You have to. And so we spoke to every surviving victim. And I had made a sort of a deal with myself before Fincher came on, where I was like, I never wanted to show any murder scene that someone wasn't a witness for. Mm-hmm. So that's why all the violence in the movie, there's a survivor or an eyewitness. Mm-hmm. And then when we really sort of drilled down, we actually went and sat down with every single person who had gone through that or was still alive. And then we talked to every detective who was still alive, who'd worked the case in the four different jurisdictions. We really went down the rabbit hole with it.
Yeah. One of the things I love about that movie is how much it reminds me of All the President's Men. And I mean, obviously, I mean, like, not just aesthetically, but again, it's so much about process, which is something I really love.
One of my favorite movies. And I was super lucky enough years later to actually direct a movie with Robert Redford. So I kind of got to be like, so what was that? You know, I sort of like, I would try and like occasionally inside the actor's studio with him. So like, no.
So talk about that. Like, the movie you're talking about is Truth. Yeah. And is that's the only movie you've directed so far of your own script, right?
Yes.
So what's that like? You know, you've worked with directors like David Fincher, and then you're directing your own film, and you're dealing with people like Robert Redford, who's, you know, quite a director in his own right. What's that like for you as a first timer?
It was like, I think it was so terrifying that I wasn't able to be terrified. Like, I feel like it was like, if I'd had, because I had this insane cat. So the movie was about, was a true story about a woman named Mary Mapes who was a producer at 60 Minutes. And she produced all of Dan Rather's stuff. And she got a hold of a story that then President Bush had possibly been AWOL from his time in the National Guard. And they researched the story, they ran the story, and then it blew up in their face. And it's a process story movie. It's like All the President's Men, mm-hmm. you know, in that way, or Zodiac in that way. And I was sort of fascinated with that, and fascinated not with the politics of it, but sort of what it said about where journalism was going, because it's sort of the first time that the internet kind of rose up and pulled down a journalistic story. And now we're way down that road. But so I was just like, look, I love this piece. It's a small piece. Like, I know I want to direct it. I don't want to give it to someone else. And hopefully I can get a cast for it. And somehow, through the grace of God, we sent it to Cate Blanchett the day after she won the Academy Award for Blue Jasmine. And I was like, well, there's no way, you know. And she read it and she responded. And we had this whole conversation we had a 45-minute conversation on the phone. And she's like, okay, I'll do it. And then Redford, I had known from, I'd written something a couple of years before that he was going to direct. So I knew him a little bit. And I wanted him to play Dan. So I sent it to him. And he said yes. And then suddenly, if you have those two, you run the table, like, sure, in terms of casting. And so I remember there's a part in it that I wanted, I was talking to John Papsidera, our casting director, and I said, he's like, who are you thinking? I was like, you know, we should get like somebody sort of like Elizabeth Moss. And he was like, well, what about Elizabeth Moss? And I was like, yeah, no, but like, she's not going to do it. And he was like, no, she wants to do the movie. And I was like, what? So we had this amazingly insane cast. Stacey Keach came in for a week. It was, you know, like people like that who uh-huh. aren't necessarily box office draws, but if you're a fan of
you've ever seen movies, Fat City.
Oh my God. I mean, and also, by the way, like, I'm a child of the 80s. So like, he also weirdly was Mike Hammer for me. So it's like, he kind of checked all the boxes. But so I, because it was such a crazy cast, I think it helped that I was like, well, I just can't be afraid of them. Cause if I am, I'll turn into just a puddle of goo. And like the second scene I had to do was on my first day, was Cate Blanchett, Dennis Quaid, Topher Grace, and Elizabeth Moss sitting around a table. And it's like, the last thing I had directed before that was a student film in college where a giant penguin attacks the city, and I used a stuffed animal as the penguin. Like, the dumbest thing.
I imagine you showed that to Redford before, like during prep.
I sadly did not. I was like, we are not going to let this man know anything about it. But it was an amazing experience. I do remember that was the first day. And we shot for 3 weeks before Redford started. We knew he was going to start. And the day he started on the movie, Kate came up to me and she's like, I changed 3 times before I came here, even though I knew I was going into the makeup trailer. It's just like, she's like, I'm so nervous. Like, aren't you nervous to be directing Robert Redford? And I looked at her, I was like, you're Cate Blanchett. Like, I'm just getting used to you. What are we talking about? Like, what is my life? So, and that was, it was an amazing experience. And then I finished the movie and I came home and I just sort of had to be like, oh, that's Kate and Bob, who I work with, you know? And I came home and it was like 2 weeks later and I was flipping around cable one night and Butch Cassidy was on. And I, like, you know, every time Butch Cassidy's on, I end up watching at least some of it. And, yeah. And I was watching it. Yeah, and it's just, it's one of the greats, and William Goldman and all of that. And so, like, I watched about 10 minutes of it, and Redford's on screen, and I almost had a nervous breakdown on my couch, because all of the stuff of, like, who he really is and the history he has in film crashed in on me in that moment. I went, oh my God, I directed Robert Redford in a movie. Oh my God. Oh my God. So it was an amazing experience. It's one of the great experiences of my life.
Do you plan to direct again?
I do. Yeah. No, I'd really, really like to. It's you know, listen, directing is, it takes so much of you in a wonderful way. Before I did it, I sat down with a lot of directors who I knew and sort of said, you know, hey, I'm going to buy you lunch for the next 2 hours. Tell me everything I need to know about directing a movie. And Dean Pariseau, who was wonderful and is about to do Bill and Ted 3, which is awesome.
That's awesome.
Which I'm so excited about. But who is one of the, is incredibly talented and also one of the nicest people you will ever meet. Looked at me and said, it is the hardest job you will have and it's the most fun job you will ever have. And he was absolutely right. And it was fantastic, but it takes so much of you. And I, at the time, had really young kids. I had a 3-year-old and a 4-year-old. And we moved, I had to move them to, we shot the movie in Sydney. I had to move them to Sydney. And it was hard. It was hard on my wife. It was hard on my kids. And I just kind of got to a place afterwards where I said, look, I don't want to miss their childhood. And so the last few years, it's been about almost 5 years since I did it. I've been more at home producing more and written more, and that's sort of been a conscious choice. And now I'm sort of there at the age where I'm sort of ready to go off and do it again. I don't know if anybody will let me, but I'm, you know, I definitely, it's something I want to tackle again.
So on the flip side of that, as a writer, what's it like, you know, when you just relinquish control of a script and here you go? Is that, you know, difficult for you? Or is that something you've made your peace with?
I think I've made my peace with it. I also sort of feel like, you know, as a writer, like, it's a collaborative medium. Do you know what I mean? And no one person can make a movie. I feel like if you're a screenwriter and you're just trying to control, and this is true of being a director too, you're doing yourself a disservice because you're closing yourself off to all of the sort of wonderful things that can happen when you let actors in, when you let a director in with their own ideas, when you let a producer in with their own ideas. And so I feel like, listen, it's like, it's, you know, somebody put it to me. It's like, you know, it's sending your kids off to college. Like, eventually they're going to have to go off and do what they do. And even when you direct a movie, you don't have total control of it. You don't, you know, and you don't have control of how people perceive it. So there's always that moment of letting go and kind of giving it up to the world. And I sort of feel like the more open you are to that and the more open you are to other people's input and possibilities for it, the better the movie will be. And also the better your experience will be, too. Because it's never going to be exactly as it was in your head or on the page the first time or on the page the last time.
Now, you've jumped around genres a lot as well as a writer. Has that been an intentional choice on your part, or is it, you know, kind of just happenstance?
It's just sort of the stuff I'm attracted to, I think, is, you know, is sort of different genre stuff. And really early in my career, the first thing I sold, I sort of said, was a comedy. And so I spent a year kind of known as a comedy writer. And I would go out on these general meetings and people would sort of pitch me. It was sort of right when American Pie had come out. So everybody was trying to figure out how to make sex comedies. And I was just like, I don't know how to do that. And at the same time, I was writing this movie that ended up becoming Basic, which is assuredly not a comedy.
Did you, just out of curiosity about with Basic, was that something, you know, the other thing I remember besides John Travolta being shirtless is the sort of Rashomon structure. Was that something you started out with?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I wanted to tell a mystery, because it is a mystery, like, you know, and they say, like, don't call it a mystery, so I was like, okay, it's a military thriller. But it was always, I wanted to do a story that was about someone who's a great interrogator, who, like, that's their skill set. He's not a, you know, he's not a badass, you know, fighter. He's not a, you know, he, you know, it's his weapon is his mouth and his brain. And I sort of loved the idea of that. And originally, the movie had a completely different ending, which was sort of the reason I wrote the movie, which was I wanted to tell a story where at the end, a mystery story where at the end you find out the detective's the killer. And so that's what the script was. So it was always sort of Rashomon. It was always sort of that. And so I was working on it and I went to my manager and I sort of said, listen, I'm writing this spec. And I sort of told him about it. And he said, yeah, but, you know, you sold a comedy, like you're a comedy writer. You know, that's, you don't want to necessarily confuse people. And I was like, well, listen, I'm almost done with it. Do me a favor. You'll read it. And if you don't like it, we'll put it in a drawer and nobody ever has to see it. And then we can go and I'll figure out how to write a sex comedy, I guess. I don't know. And I gave it to him and he read it and he was like, actually, this is really good. I think I can sell this. And he sold it. And it was like this great lesson I learned. I got to learn this lesson super early in my career, which was great, which was you don't have to let people define you in terms of the genre you work in. And so after that, I was like, oh, I can, if I want to try this, I can try this. If I want to try that, I can try that. And it's like the next movie I did after that was, it was called The Rundown, which was a Dwayne Johnson's second movie, which was a buddy action comedy. So
yeah, Sean William Scott.
Sean Scott.
Great one, actually.
Oh, thanks, man.
And a great Christopher Walken monologue, by the way.
About the Tooth Fairy, yes.
Yeah, one of his best.
Thank you. That means a lot. Thanks. I love the fact.
Another thing that's interesting, looking through your credits is White House Down, which is, in my opinion, the better of the two White House action movies that year. That's one of those things from the outside, you know, we look at when people see, you know, Deep Impact and Armageddon or, you know, what have you. What's it like when you're like involved in that? Is that kind of thing on your radar that, you know, oh crap, there's another one of these in development, or are you just focusing on your work?
You're focusing on your, it's funny because it's like we knew about it and it was, I always sort of thought this is, I couldn't believe no one had ever done this as a movie. And I'd had the idea for years and I wrote it. And right before I sent it to my agent, I opened Deadline and this spec had sold with the exact same blog line. I was like, oh, you gotta be kidding me. and I said to my, I almost didn't tell her. Like I literally almost just put it again, put it in a drawer. And then I was like, I should tell her I wrote something, you know, cause I'm always sort of working on a spec. I always like to have a secret spec that nobody knows about just cause it's like, oh, if I haven't told anyone, then if it stinks, I can never show it to them and I won't disappoint them. But I called her and I was like, look, you should know I wrote this thing, but it's exactly the same. And she was like, send it to me. And I sent it to her and she's like, okay, well, maybe we can figure out a way to, you know, if they're not in production yet, maybe we can figure out a way. And then what happened was the script actually, and I don't know how, leaked out, I think of the agency. And she started getting incoming calls about it. And she was like, I didn't send it to you. And then people started bidding on it. And then there was a bidding war for it. And then Sony ended up being like, no, we'll buy it and we'll make it. And I was like, well, that's a great idea. Let's that's much better than the drawer, you know? And they, you know, they brought Roland Emmerich in like the next day and greenlit the movie. And so we were in this crazy rush to production. And we always knew they were working and we always knew that they were going to come out first. But it was so interesting because like the studio would do this thing and they're like, look, we've done analysis. Like there were two Snow White movies and the first movie, you know, and the Julia Roberts one came out first, but the second one made the most money. There was Deep Impact and Armageddon. Deep Impact came out first, but Armageddon was the one that made the most money. So they were very much like, we're going to be okay. We're going to be fine. Because historically it's really about the second movie and the one that's sort of better done. And by the way, your mileage may vary. You might love Olympus Has Fallen more than our movie. Totally get it. Absolutely. Like there's a ton of fun stuff in that movie, but that movie came out and was huge. And I think we all were like,
it was a bit of a surprise, right? Cause that one came out early, I think in like early March or something like that. Right.
It was early March and it was a big hit and we were in summer and it was a really interesting is the wrong way to put it. Cause it sucks to write a movie that goes down as hard as that movie went down. And so many people worked on it who I love, so many people at that studio. I love Roland. I love all those guys. And it was not an easy movie to make because we made it so fast and we were shooting 6 day weeks and 15 hour days. And like, it was a rough sled. And so at the end of all of that, to kind of then, you know, just hit the concrete, you know, was a super bummer. The lesson that I sort of took from it too was because we came out July 4th. Like we were like big Roland Emmerich movie on July 4th. And it was like, oh, summer isn't what it was, but like summer has changed. Because our movie, you know, it's like, it's a high concept movie, not a sequel, not a
super old fashioned.
It's a good old fashioned, and good old fashions don't work in the summer anymore, you know? And to her credit, Amy Pascal, who ran the studio, said, look, I want to release, they had just put Skyfall out in a November slot. And she said, I want to do this in November. It'll give us, you know, we'll be farther away from them. And other people involved in the movie were like, no, it's Roland. It's July 4th. And, you know, Olympus Has Fallen will be on home video by that point in time. It'll be on digital. Like we got to, you know, and it didn't work.
So let's take just a little bit of a step back and just talk about writing in general. What's your writing day like? What's your process?
Usually during I have kids, so I used to write at night, and they put an end to that. So because I am unconscious at night, you know, I get up in the morning, get the kids to school, then either go to my office or go to, you know, a restaurant or something like that, and just try and work for most of the morning, and then have lunch. And if I've done enough work in the morning, I go, oh, I'm done for the day. And then I tricked. My life is basically about tricking myself into writing without thinking I'm writing. So, like, it's just a series of cons I'm pulling on myself. So I do a lot of stuff longhand in notebooks, and I'm just like, I'm just making notes. Well, maybe this guy could say this. Well, maybe this guy could say this. Maybe this guy could say this. And then I'm like, aha, I wrote a scene. Fooled you, me. And then, I in the afternoon, I'll do some stuff I need to do for, make phone calls. And I'm also, I've been lucky enough to be able to produce things that I haven't written. So there's work to be done on that stuff. And then if I'm a good boy and I'm super, good about around 4 o'clock, I try and start writing again and maybe get another hour or two in. So that is me. That is on a good day, me being very diligent. And that's usually when I'm in the middle of a draft of something.
Yeah. So what about outlining and things like that? What's your pre-writing? Before you get to the script, what are you doing?
It's funny. So the older I get, the more I pre-write. Like, I think it's really helpful, and it's certainly helpful for me. And I used to not do it as much. I used to kind of just do a very loose outline, and I was like, I'm an artist, I'll find it on the page. And sometimes that works. And so, it's great. But like, the more I do it, again, it's part of that thing of tricking myself into not knowing I'm writing, is like, the more I sort of outline, I'll do a pretty involved outline now. And then I'll have snippets of dialogue. And I try and, when I start a project, I try to not think about structure for a while. And I literally just go, what do I want to see? What would be fun? What would be interesting? What's a cool scene? And I'll just kind of try and collect all of these things that are sort of inspire me, or the best version of this movie would have something like this happen in it. And then slowly but surely that'll fall into, okay, well, if I want that, like, how would it open? If I like that scene, how do I get to that scene? And so a structure will kind of slowly take shape. But I think there's so much benefit to the part of the process where you're just dreaming about it and just sort of like untethered to page count, structure, like just letting your mind go. I feel like really good stuff comes out of that. And then eventually I'll sort of structure and go, okay, what's act one, what's act two, what's act three. I usually know where I want the movie to begin and end pretty easily. And then you sort of figure out the signposts in there. And then you just kind of fill it in more and more and more. I don't use cards. I've tried to. I know people love the cards. Just for me, for some reason, it's so much. So I do a lot of black and white composition books and just sort of make lists, make character names, do all that stuff. And eventually I write some version of an outline. And then the last few years, and this is also partially because some of the studio jobs I've done now require it because deals have changed, is I'll do a treatment, which I didn't like to do as much before. But again, now I'm more interested in it because I find, again, I'm breaking the story and writing the story, but I'm not in script pages yet. So it still feels like it's fungible, and there's time to like, take this, throw it out too. So and then finally, many moons later, I try and write a first draft as quickly as humanly possible.
So what kind of deadlines do you give yourself, and how long does it usually take you to write a draft?
I don't actually give myself deadlines that much anymore, just because I have so much guilt. I'm a Presbyterian WASP from Connecticut, so I can guilt myself pretty easily in terms of being like, come on, you're not writing fast enough. But I just sort of feel like with the first draft, it's always a situation where if I don't write it fast enough, it, like, the patient will die on the table. So I'm like, because I've had that happen. And I'm like, oh, just finish it. It doesn't matter if it sucks. All first draft sucks. Just finish it. And of course, when you write a first draft, or at least when I write a first draft, I, for some reason, always forget that first drafts are first drafts and they suck. So it's like I finish and I go, oh, thank God. And then I have a deal with myself where I don't reread it immediately because whenever you reread it, I feel like it's just like, you're like, oh, this is the worst piece of shit I've ever seen in my life. I should be thrown out of Hollywood immediately.
So that doesn't go away.
No, that never goes away. But for some reason, you always forget it before. But I do. I finally did make a deal with myself where it's like, I do put that first draft aside for 2 weeks. I do not open it. I do not look at it. I work on something else so that when I come back to it, at least I have a little bit of space and clarity, and I'm able to sort of go, okay, It is still, it still does feel like the worst piece of shit ever, but I can probably make it better, as opposed to, I feel like if you read it right away, it's just, you know, it's gut wrenching.
Is, you know, along the way, are you sharing it with people, or, you know, do you, is there a point, you know, at which, okay, now this is shareable, or are you sharing it with people at all stages?
I don't share until I've done a couple passes. Listen, if I get super, super stuck and I'm working with a producer I really, really trust or another writer, then I'll share it at that point, or I'll just talk something through. But I like to have a couple bites at the apple first, just myself. And then usually I'll start to share it with people I know who are other writers who I've known forever, you know, for like 20 years, whose opinions I trust and who I know will tell me the truth and are much smarter than I. And who those people are, I think, depends kind of project to project. And then I'll do another pass based off that. And then I'll share it with whether it's the studio or producer or director, then it goes there.
So when you're getting that feedback and, you know, from writers that you're friends with, or that you, you know, your work producers that you're working with, how do you work with that? Because sometimes it can be easy to take every note really personally. How do you handle that?
I think it's really important to not take notes personally, you know, and that doesn't mean it's easy, you know, it can be really, really hard, but I think it's just, you know, you have to, you know, everyone's trying to make it better and you have to be open to that. And I also sort of feel like I take notes, the level of, I think you can never take every note, because I think that's just a bad idea, and you can never take no notes, you know what I mean? So there's no version where your first draft or second draft or even third draft is perfect. So you have to be open to the fact that, and working with people who are trying to make it better. And listen, there, you know, sometimes there are certain people on projects who you go, oh, I think that guy's not that smart. So you don't take as many notes to them. But what I have found over the years is that it's kind of like when you're, you know, if you're a hypochondriac or you start to feel something and you go on WebMD, like, not everyone's a doctor. So, but people do know their bodies. So if somebody comes into the doctor and says, doc, something's wrong with my leg, that's like somebody saying, like, I think you have a second act problem. It's like what they think the second act problem may not be the problem, but they're not a doctor, but you are. So don't dismiss the fact that they have an issue in this section of the script. There may be something that's not quite working here, but it's up to you to figure out what it is, not them. So I feel like that's, you know, sometimes the spirit in which you have to take notes. Now, if you're, again, it depends on who you're dealing with. So, like, you know, the people who I know who are writers who I trust and I have a shorthand with, like, they usually are more able to go, oh, you have a second act problem because of this. And more often than not, they're right about that. Whereas, you know, some producers are not as well versed in that, and some directors are not as well versed in that, and their feelings might be more, they might be less prescriptively helpful and more generally helpful of here's where you should look. I always sort of feel like with you know, when doing notes, and again, it also depends on, like, are you doing notes on your draft for you to figure out how to get to the best place, or are you doing specific notes for a studio? But when you're doing notes for a studio or notes for a director or notes for an actor, I think it's always helpful to kind of give them what they want, or give them what they need, not necessarily what they want, and make sure you're actually addressing something, because you can't just go, no, you're wrong, it's perfect. Like, that's not an answer.
No, that makes total sense. So as we're wrapping up, one last question. So you've had, you know, you've been working for how long now? A couple decades, it sounds, I think. That's crazy. Is there one thing you know now that you wish you knew when you were first starting out, that if you, you know, you could go back and tell yourself that you would?
That's a great question. I think it really goes back to just the being open to things and being open to other people. You know, sort of being a writer is such an insular by nature, and I don't have a partner either. So I'm not in a writing team. There's nobody else in the room with me. And so you work so hard, you pour yourself into these things. Even, by the way, it's like, even if, you know, it's like, people are like, you worked so hard and poured yourself into White House Down. It's like, yeah, I did. Like, I know it's a silly, silly movie where Channing Tatum runs around with a machine gun in the West Wing, but I did. And that's fun. And you care, and you have to care, by the way. That's the other thing. It's like, if you're writing something, you don't care about it, then you shouldn't be writing it. But I think the thing that I've learned is really to try and let go of the control of it and be open to things, because if you're not, you'll miss great stuff. You'll miss great ideas coming from other people. You'll miss things that will elevate the movie and make the movie better. Because at the end of the day, it's about the movie. It's not about you. It's, you know, if you want to be that kind of writer, go write a book. fantastic, you know, but, you know, you're making a movie with over 100 other artisans, ultimately, hopefully, or a television series. The writers and directors and actors that I've worked with who have long careers and are wonderful are all, almost all open and excited about collaboration. And if you conduct yourself in that way, it will be easier for you to have a career because people will go, oh, that person's great. And the last thing I will say is, and I had a professor at USC who's since passed on, who taught me this, was Seth. His name was Seth Winston, and he was great. And he would talk about when you get notes, and he would say, he said, if you get a note that doesn't really matter, take it. That's like, hey, man, like maybe this takes place, maybe it's raining outside. If it doesn't matter, take the note. It's fine. If you get a note that's helpful, you make a huge deal out of it. You go, well, that's, if we did that, that's great, because that means that she would come off more as, oh, that's fantastic. That solves a whole other thing. But and make a big deal, make them feel good about it because they have contributed. They've done a wonderful job. And if you do both of those things, when the note that is going to screw your script up comes down the pike, the thing that's the hand grenade, you know, because it always happens at some point. If you've earned their trust, you're able to sort of say, listen, I understand why you would want to do that, but I'm just worried that if we do that, then this happens and this happens and it'll domino into this. They'll look at you and go, well, I mean, this guy was so great about, you know, about the other stuff. And like, you'll have earned their trust. You'll have earned their trust enough to actually protect the movie from that one bad note. But if you've been trying to control everything and don't you, why would we change it to a rainstorm? That's stupid. Like, then you won't be able, you'll be the boy who cried wolf. You won't be able to protect the script. So that's something I think I was told at a young age, it's really hard to do sometimes. It's hard to sort of be that open. But as my career has gone along, I wish I had been more open at the beginning of my career and followed that advice a little more closely.
Well, I think that is a absolutely great note to leave on. James, thank you very much for joining us.
My pleasure. And please check out Murder Mystery on Netflix. And I just have to quickly plug, so you didn't get to talk about it, but I produced a wonderful movie that was written by two of my best friends, Guy Busick and R. Christopher Murphy. And it's called Ready or Not. It's Fox Searchlight. It's coming out on August 23rd. The trailer's online right now. It's this amazing, comedy thriller. And Samara Weaving, Andy McDowell, Adam Brody. It's fantastic. Please check out the trailer. Please go check out the movie.
Yeah, I did check out that trailer yesterday. And maybe we'll have to get them on the podcast to talk about it.
Please, they're awesome guys. They're great.
All right, well, we're going to reach out right after this. James Vanderbilt, thanks again.
Thanks so much for having me. Take care.
Take care. Thanks again to James Vanderbilt. Murder Mystery is streaming on Netflix right now. And thank you to all of our listeners. If you haven't already, please subscribe on iTunes and leave us a review. You can also stay in the know by following us on Facebook or find us on Twitter @FinalDraftInc and Instagram @FinalDraftScreenwriting. Until next time, write on.